आप सबको एक बार फिर से जय मसीह की। मुझे आशा है कि आपके दिन अच्छे गुजर रहे हैं, आप घर पे हैं और कई लोगों को बोरियत फील हो रही है, लेकिन फिर भी आपको शुक्र मनाना चाहिए कि आप घर पे हैं। बिकॉज अगर आप इंडिया की हालत देखें तो बहुत से लोग अपने घर पहुंचने के लिए बहुत जद्दोजहद कर रहे हैं, बट हर हाल हर परिस्थिति में, जैसा कि पहला थिस्सलुनीकियों उसका 5 अध्याय कहता है कि धन्यवाद दें परमेश्वर का और उसके नाम को महिमा दें। वेल, आई एम श्योर कि बीते जितने भी एपिसोड रहे हैं आप उन सब में आशीषित हुए हैं। और आज हमारे साथ में मेरे बहुत ही अच्छे मित्र पास्टर जैबी जुड़ रहे हैं। पास्टर जैबी, आपका स्वागत है। पास्टर जैबी और मैं, हम दोनों बाइबल कॉलेज में एक साथ पढ़े हैं और बहुत खुशी होती है जब आप अपने दोस्तों को, अपने मित्रों को मिनिस्ट्री में इतनी ऊंचाई पर जाता देखते हैं और उनसे आशीष पाते हैं। मैं सच में प्रभु का धन्यवाद देता हूं पास्टर जैबी उनकी लाइफ के लिए। करंटली ही सर्विंग एज अ पास्टर इन गुड़गांव, दिल्ली NCR, गुड़गांव इंडिया। द चर्च इज कॉल्ड ग्लोबल क्रिश्चियन लाइफ सेंटर अंडर द लीडरशिप ऑफ पास्टर रॉबर्ट जयराज। और अगर आप गुड़गांव क्षेत्र में रहते हैं तो कभी समय निकालिए और जरूर विजिट कीजिए ग्लोबल क्रिश्चियन लाइफ सेंटर। आई एम श्योर यू विल नेवर बी डिसअपॉइंटेड। इट विल बी वन ऑफ योर बेस्ट 2 hours और 3 hours स्पेंट इन द प्रेजेंस ऑफ गॉड। सो आइए हम आगे बढ़ते हैं। कुछ सवाल हैं आज हमारे पास में एक बार फिर से पूछने के लिए, एंड हम उन सवालों को पास्टर जैबी से इस समय पूछेंगे। थैंक यू पास्टर जैबी फॉर ज्वाइनिंग अस दिस मॉर्निंग एंड गिविंग अस दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी एंड टाइम दैट वी कैन शेयर दिस गॉडली कॉन्वर्सेशन।
थैंक यू एशली भाई फॉर हैविंग मी हियर विद यू एंड द एपिसोड्स दैट यू हैव डन इन गॉड टॉक। एक्सीलेंट कंटेंट, very creative as Ashley Bayes. Thank you so much for doing what you're doing. Great to be here.
Praise the Lord. As I said earlier, Pastor Jebby, you've been pastor for quite some years now. And this season that we are going through is unprecedented. Kisi ne bhi is सीजन के बारे में सोचा नहीं था, ना ही कल्पना की थी, एंड देयरफॉर वी आर नेवर रेडी कि ऐसा कुछ आगे आएगा भी। और इस सीजन के अंदर जो सबसे बड़ा चैलेंज है वो ये नहीं है कि हमारे जो चर्च की बिल्डिंगें बंद हो गई हैं या फिर हम लोग लॉकडाउन में हैं। एक सबसे बड़ा चैलेंज है वो है डिस्टेंस हो गया है, और उस डिस्टेंस की वजह से आज बहुत से लोग हैं जो कि घरों में अकेले हैं, और स्पेशली जो भी आसपास जो सिनेरियो है, द सिचुएशन दैट इज अराउंड अस, बिकॉज ऑफ दैट अ लॉट ऑफ पीपल लूजिंग देयर होप डे बाय डे। बिकॉज फर्स्ट वी थॉट दैट इट विल बी जस्ट 20 days, then it was 30 days, then 40 days, and now, you know, it's keep going on, and people, we don't know when it's going to end. So in this difficult time, while people are, you know, literally losing their hope, how as a pastor you would encourage people, and also if you can share how as a believer can remain encouraged in this difficult time and season.
You know, Ashibai, as you rightly said, this is unprecedented time. And none of us have pastored churches times like this. None of us have preached to people hope in times like this. Because I see it in two ways. One is the fear of death that is prevailing in the whole universe, in the whole country as a whole, because of the of this COVID-19 situation. That is in one side. Another thing is the impending disaster that is coming upon the economy. So many people are going to lose jobs, and pay cuts are happening. And so we have two major issues to deal with: a huge sickness that is devouring people and an impending economic disaster that might make people lose job and, you know, without any such help. As a pastor, I would say it's difficult, but the only hope is to bring people back to scripture and to say that, you know, there is a God who is still in control, and this is not our final destination. This is not the place that we're going to stay forever. Till we cross over, the Good Shepherd is going to walk with us through the quiet pastures, through the green, through the green pastures, through the quiet waters. When we go through the valley of shadow of death, the consistent thing for a sheep like us is the presence of the shepherd. So reassuring people of the presence of God who is in the midst of the trouble, I think that would be the only solace that we can give it to people.
Wow. And, you know, no matter what, it is a difficult time. And I believe as we go on, the only hope that we have is Jesus. The only hope that we have is the love and the promises that we receive in the Word of God. But as we move on, you know, sometimes those promises, people take it as a chant. You know, people take it as a mantra, not understanding how really the word works. Because of our cultural understanding, a lot of people, they think that just saying something can do something for them, especially when it comes to the religious understanding. And I am hearing a lot of people are saying that, oh, just say Psalm 91 morning, afternoon and night, and it'll be all good. Now, I don't want to really go into the detail of that, but I want to really talk about, because the understanding behind that act is that as a Christian, nothing can touch me. As a Christian, suffering can not penetrate in my life. So as a Christian, when I become a Christian, I want to ask you, what is your take on suffering after one become a Christian? And also, can we safely say that no sickness can really touch me when I become a follower of Jesus Christ?
Ashivai, this is, I'm so happy that you're asking this question. At the same time, the church as a whole is given a big opportunity to find a space for suffering in their theology during this time. Because we somehow ejected that whole idea of suffering from our theology. We said that once we have become child of God, once you accept Jesus Christ, it is all going to be great. I mean, sub changasi type, you know, nothing is going to touch you. Nothing is going to affect you, because the blood covering is that. Is where we say that word, Psalm 91, left hand side, these many will be fall, right hand side, these many, nothing is going to touch me. But the problem with that kind of an idea is, it is a psalm that is addressing to a particular place and a particular issue in the life of the Israelites, believed to be written by Moses, that talks about longevity of life. But at the same time, Psalm 90 talks about the brevity of life. So we need to find a balance between a psalm that assures us the longevity and also talks about the brevity. My life is just this much. And how can I balance it both and see that, okay, where do I stand with my theology, or where do I stand with my understanding of God in the midst of this struggle? As you have asked me about sickness, I mean, if I am a believer, can I say that no sickness will come? Okay. I just want to show a verse. Can I just read a verse for you? Okay. Interesting verse in Galatians. This is Paul, the preacher. He is going for the first missionary journey. He goes to this province called Galatia, and he is with his friend Barnabas. And once he reaches there, he falls ill. Okay. In Lystra, in Galatia, there is healing happening. Lame is walking, and they want to make him God. Give him sacrifice. That kind of an episode is happening. But at the same time, see this man, how he is looking at gospel. Galatians chapter 4, verse number 13. Galatians verse number 13, 14, it says like this. As you know, it was because of an illness that I first preached the gospel to you. Because of an illness, he preached the gospel first to the people. Oftentimes we made a gospel that has nothing to do with the gospel that Paul preached. We said once you come to the gospel, there is no sickness. But here the preacher who can heal the sick through the anointing and the gifting that flows through him is saying that, I came there, I preached there, I healed the sick. How and when? When I myself was in illness. And in a way he's saying that it is because of my illness I ended up there. He might have wanted to go northward and reach other place. Because illness limited him, he ended up in this particular place, he started a church. But somewhere we understood the blood covering wrong. Somewhere we understood the blessings wrong. Somewhere we made physical healing an integral part of our salvation, which is not biblically, then preached the gospel and gave a false hope to people that it is not going to touch. Again, I have to make it clear, some people might disagree with me saying that God heals. Yes, God heals. I believe I am a recipient of that healing. My mother is a testimony of that healing. But at the same time, I want to say, why does he heal? Oftentimes he heals to meet our felt need, that is our physical need, so that he can take us to the real need. In the situation of the gospel, he heals us so that our physical need will be met, and thus he gets the ear for our spiritual ear will be open to receive the greater good, that is the healing of our soul. That's why he heals the blind man first, and then he talks about, I am the light of the world. So his aim is to speak the spiritual healing, and he gets the ear for that message by doing the physical healing. He still does that. God still heals, but once you are under the blood, sickness will not touch. I doubt, because today we lost a great giant of faith.
Yes.
Immediately. I mean, 74 years old. We had the privilege of meeting him 3 months back in one of the pastor's convents. He said, I'm going to go for a 2-month break and get my back right. I will be back on the road. That's what he said. But all of a sudden, we are saying goodbye. Does it mean that he was not covered by the blood of the Lamb? Does it mean that he didn't have the revelation to apply Psalm 91 on his life? Or does it mean that he has lesser knowledge of the healing power of God? I think we have to reconcile it and say that there is a sovereign God. In this world, we have trouble. As sons, we have to go through sufferings, as Romans chapter 8 says, and we continue that journey. But still, we trust in the goodness of God.
This is so amazing as you're discussing it. You know, I personally getting a lot of understanding that you are unfolding, because bahut se log hain, there's so many people out there who are so adamant not believing in what you're saying. And as you said correctly, and I want to come and go with you, aapne kaha ki jo healing hai, jo changai hai, has become an integral part of salvation. I believe that. I believe in healing. You know, again, jitne bhi sun rahe hain, main aap sabko kehna chahta hun, neither Pastor Jaybi, neither me, we are not here against healing. We are not. You know, I have preached on healing. I have seen healing taking place while I preach and minister. So, you know, that is out of question. But hum log kya kehna cha rahe hain? Hum log ye kehna cha rahe hain ki healing is not the ultimate plan. Healing is not the ultimate plan of God. And beautifully, Pastor Jaybi ne bataya ki jab Paulus bimar tha, Prabhu ne us bimari ke dwara ek 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 town, ek shahar ke andar susamachar ka rasta khola. Right? And in fact, aap bhi jab gospel bar bar padhenge, aap yahi dekhenge ki jo bimariyan thi. For example, Lazar ko Prabhu ne 4 din baad zinda kiya, lekin ek samay aaya jab Lazar fir mar gaya. Theek hai? Healing will take place, but for how long? You know, hamare Daud kehta hai, the days of my life are numbered. Gine hue hain. Ab kitna healing le lenge? But there is greater plan of God beyond that healing, behind that healing. Ki Prabhu uske dwara aapki attention lena chahta hai aur aapki atma ko changa karna chahta hai. So Pastor Jaybi, with that question and understanding. A lot of people have this question in their mind कि जब मैं मसीह में आ गया, आने के बाद में मैं बीमार हो गया हूँ, या I'm going through a difficult time, or I'm suffering through a particular phase of my life. कई बार ये सवाल हमारे दिल में उठता है, and including me, earlier I had this same question. क्या परमेश्वर मुझसे मेरे पापों का बदला ले रहा है? और is there a sin in my life? क्या कोई पाप है मेरे जीवन में जिसकी वजह से मैं ब्लेस नहीं हो रहा हूं, मैं बीमार हूं, मैं पुअर हूं? आप इसके बारे में क्या कहेंगे?
Ashwin, it's a very beautiful question because this is a common understanding that everybody has. We say if you do good, good should happen. If you do bad, bad should happen. When Jesus was on this earth, a blind man came to Jesus, and his disciples went to him and asked, "See, Jesus, tell us whose sin is the cause for this sickness." So we want simplistic answers, and the disciples were saying, they said, "Okay, whose sin? We know sin is the cause of the sickness. Whose sin it is? It is the sin of the blind man or the sin of his father, his forefathers?" So what is Jesus given? An either or answer, either this or this, A or B. We just have to settle that there. But sometimes it is beyond that. Jesus brings a third category there, and Jesus says, no, this sickness is for the glory of God to be seen. So now we have a totally different understanding about sickness, that there are some problems that can come in our lives just for the glory of God to be seen. And God uses that situation so beautifully and brings in one of the finest revelation about the Son, Jesus Christ, in that chapter. I'm talking about John chapter 9. So when we look at this whole issue of sickness, Ashley Bhai, I think we need to understand the place that we are in this world, because it is a decaying world. We are in a decaying world. Romans chapter 8 talks about it, because everything in the creation is subjected to the curse that was happening. We, our spiritual curse is broken. We are right with God, but still our bodily resurrection hasn't happened. We are waiting for that. So till that moment, what happens is we will have sicknesses in our body. Okay, this will end, right? Somewhere this body will end. We were talking about praying for the sickness a while ago. See, Apostle Paul's example of praying for Epaphroditus is a beautiful example. He came from Philippi to the prison. He fell ill. Apostle was thinking that he's going to die, and sorrow upon sorrow will happen to him. So he prayed. He prayed that healing will take place. And Bible says, I mean, God had mercy on me and God healed him. See, this is the same Paul who prayed just one prayer to raise up Eutychus, who fell from the top window and died while Paul was preaching. So there is the same Paul who prays one prayer to raise the dead, and there is the same Paul in the prison who is praying an extensive prayer to heal the sickness of a man called Epaphroditus. So we need to reconcile these things. We need to see that, okay, there are some moments that God will come through to us and say that, okay, immediate healing. Sometimes it will take time. It is in the sovereign hand of God. We cannot insist that all the time it should happen. Sometimes God will say, my grace is enough. You're going to walk with it. My grace will fill your area of weakness. You will continue with it. And as we have read earlier in Galatians chapter 4, in sickness we have to heal people. And sometimes we are hurting healers. We are hurting at the same time through us the healing flows. So the simplistic understanding that if you are right with God, sickness should not touch, cannot have New Testament backup, especially in the life of Paul, because he was persecuted, he was in sickness, he went through so many trials, and his life and his disciples' life also see sickness. So I think it is safe to not to associate our spiritual standing with our physical healing.
This is also important because while we are recording this early morning, I got up with the news that the giant of faith of our generation, you know, Dr. Ravi Zacharias, he, you know, entered in the glory.
Yeah.
And he was all good 2 months back. He was traveling. He was preaching. And I think you met him a few months
ago. Yeah, you know, that's a beautiful lesson for me personally. It happened. We met in a pastor's conference, and he was ministering. He was telling that I'm going to take a 2 month break, and I'm going to set my back right because there was some issue with his back. And nobody knew he is going to be diagnosed with this serious sickness. And nobody, and even after that, he was thinking that he will be up and running in another 2 or 3 months when the hair comes back. This was his thinking after the chemotherapy has started. So after 2 or 3 chemotherapy, suddenly this death comes in and takes him away. So how can we explain that? Why? Can we say that he was less spiritual? Can we say that he did not know Psalm 91? Can we say that he was not covered by the blood of the Lamb? So I think we need to be having a space for suffering in our theology. It doesn't mean that once you are in Christ, there is no tears, no sickness, nothing of that sort. Some of the great Christians of the generations that gone by, be it Keith Green, Jonathan Edwards, be it Jim Elliot, I mean, all such great, or Oswald Sanders, all these great people who contributed so effectively to the kingdom of God, they were called home very young, 40s, 50s, 28, Keith Green. We will think that our effectiveness in ministry will add longevity of our life. That is also may not work all the time. Sometimes you will have to say goodbye and go home. So that's where. Where do we give space for suffering in the spectrum of our theology is something that we should think, at least in this COVID situation.
I think this is an eye-opening situation because so far everybody was living with this balloon that nothing will touch me and all these, you know. But as you have been talking and as you've been mentioning, that there is a great portion of the Bible that does talk about suffering, whether it's from the Abraham side or from the Old Testament coming to the New Testament, and our master, you know, himself, Jesus, went through suffering. And so मैं भी आप सबको यही कहना चाहता हूँ पास्टर जेवी के साथ में, हमारी अंडरस्टैंडिंग जो है वो कहीं ना कहीं थोड़ी सी डिस्टॉर्ट हो गई है, क्योंकि हमें लगता है कि अगर हम सिख हैं, हम बीमार हैं, और अगर हम हमारे पास इनफ नहीं है, ये इसलिए है क्योंकि हमारे जीवन में पाप है या कोई बुराई है या परमेश्वर हमसे बदला ले रहा है। मेरे प्रियो, ऐसा बिल्कुल नहीं है। परमेश्वर आपसे नाराज नहीं है। परमेश्वर की जो नाराजगी थी वो उसने क्रूस के ऊपर यीशु मसीह के ऊपर जाहिर कर दी, और अब वो आपको और मुझे यीशु मसीह में होके देखता है, उसकी धार्मिकता में होके देखता है। अब वो आपसे नाराज नहीं है। इनफैक्ट अगर आप उसको उस पर विश्वास करते हैं, अगर आपने उसको जीवन दिया है, तो बाइबल बताती है कि अब आप उसके बेटे और बेटियां बन गए हैं, राइट? अब आप दंड के भागी नहीं हैं, राइट? राइटली, यू नो, पॉल सेज इन रोमन्स चैप्टर 8 वर्स 1, ब्यूटीफुल, कि अब जो मसीह में है उन पर दंड की आज्ञा नहीं है। तो आपके ऊपर दंड की आज्ञा नहीं है, परमेश्वर का अनुग्रह आपके ऊपर है। और जब आप बीमारियों में होकर जाते हैं, तो आप इस बात को बिल्कुल कंफ्यूज, इस बात के बिल्कुल भी कंफ्यूजन में ना आए कि अरे अब मुझ पर दंड की आज्ञा हो रही है। नहीं, यीशु मसीह ने कहा नहीं है दंड की आज्ञा। ये सिकनेसेस, ये बीमारियां और जो ये डिफिकल्टीज हैं, ये पार्ट हैं इस वर्ल्ड का, ये पार्ट हैं इस संसार का जिसमें हम जी रहे हैं। इसलिए यीशु मसीह ने कहा कि इस संसार में तुम्हें दुख होगा, तुम्हें मुसीबतें आएंगी, लेकिन धीरज रखो क्योंकि मैंने इस संसार को जीत लिया है। आमीन। हमारी आशीषें यीशु मसीह में है, हमारी आशीषें हमारे पैसे में नहीं है, हमारे स्वास्थ्य में नहीं है। ये सब चीजें एक समय के लिए हैं, उस समय के बाद ये चीजें हमसे चली जाएंगी, लेकिन हमारी आशीष जो है वो इटर्नल है। तो भाई मैं आपसे एक और सवाल पूछना चाहता हूँ इसी से रिलेटेड, क्योंकि हम लोग आशीषों की बात कर रहे हैं और बहुत से लोगों का ये व्यू है कि अगर आपके पास अच्छा स्वास्थ्य है, बहुत सारा पैसा है, अगर आपके पास में अच्छा परिवार है, नाम है, तो आप आशीषित हैं। तो उसके ऑपोजिट, अगर मेरे पास पैसा नहीं है, अगर मेरे पास नाम नहीं है, कोई मुझे जानता नहीं है, अगर मेरे पास मेरे शरीर में अच्छा स्वास्थ्य नहीं है, मैं 4 बीमारियों से होकर गुजर रहा हूं, ये सब चीज, तो क्या वो आशीषित नहीं है? आप इसके बारे में क्या कहेंगे?
See, Ashi bhai, again, why good, bad things happen to good people? That's a big question, and that is where we all, so many people lost faith in that question to try to answer. Why, if there is a good God, why bad things are happening to good people? And that is coming from the assumption that only good things should happen to the good people and bad things should happen to the bad people. Again, in Old Testament, if you go to Deuteronomy chapter 28, this is an often quoted verse by me. I mean, you must have heard it, it preached several times, because it is talking about being right with God and have healing because of that, have prosperity, material blessings because of that, and no enemies attacking you because of that, whatever you sow, reaping in great numbers because of that. So basically it is saying that if you are right with God, these kind of right things will happen. But there is a catch in it. See, this was a covenant blessing that was given to the people of Israel when they were living in the land of Israel. See, we are not going to sow the seed now. We are not living in that agricultural land that Israel was living. We are a spiritual kingdom. Yes, we have material needs, but our kingdom is spiritual. Our blessing is spiritual. Somehow, why? What happened was, we made the spiritual blessing more into material blessing and took the promises of the physical blessing and apply it in the New Testament time. So when Jesus came, so Jesus said, again, let me just go back to 28. If you see the problems of somebody who doesn't do the will of God in 28 or the curses, and compare that with the life of Paul, most of those curses of nakedness, of sickness, of people chasing him, of people attacking him, we see it in Paul's life. So how do we correlate? How do we understand it? How do we say that, okay, this man, this great man who understood God and made God known to us, we are benefited by his writing. How can we understand that he didn't have that revelation? No, it is because of the shift in the kingdom. That was a physical kingdom. Physical kingdom had physical blessing. In the new covenant, it is a spiritual kingdom. Spiritual kingdom has spiritual blessing. There it said, if you are in curse, it will be shown in your lack of material blessing. That is, if you are poor, you are accursed. Here Jesus redefines us and say that blessed those who are poor. That is Luke chapter 6. So I would encourage all our hearers to look back into Deuteronomy 28 and read that whole chapter, compare it with Paul's life, compare it with the Sermon on the Mount in chapter number 5 of Matthew and chapter number 6 of Luke. Both these places, all those things as if mentioned as curse in there, poverty or tears, abandonment, loneliness, all these things are considered to be not as curse in the new covenant. It says, when you are persecuted, when you are chased away, rejoice that your reward in heaven is great. But what was it in 28 said, when you don't obey, you will be chased away by your enemies. So there is a shift that happens. And oftentimes we don't preach about it, and our people don't understand it. When that happens, we look through the Old Testament idea. We don't look to the Old Testament promises through the lenses of finished work of Jesus, and we take that and apply it here, it may not happen. Because now we are in the spiritual kingdom, spiritual blessing and material possessions, material healings are not the sign of our spiritual standing with God in the new covenant.
Wow. So you are saying that in the new covenant, we have been blessed in the spiritual realm with the spiritual.
Yes.
And that's exactly what the New Testament takes us into the direction. Are you saying that we should not have material blessing? Are you saying that as a Christian, I only should suffer because that's how the pattern you see in the New Testament? If I'm not suffering, I'm not doing something good.
No.
So, yeah, please share on that.
Yeah, Ashibai, I would say I am not a preacher of prosperity. I am not a preacher of poverty. I am a preacher of contentment. Okay. See, the whole idea of richness. Are you rich? If you compare yourself with so many people, you are rich. And if you compare with so many other people, you are not rich. Okay. Same goes with me. I mean, I am rich to so many people. I went to meet the migrants on the streets of Delhi this morning. When I see their plight, I am rich. In their eyes, I am rich. But when I compare myself with so many other people, I am not, because it is a relative term. So we cannot say that that this person is rich, he is not spiritual. So my thing is, my understanding is, let's not associate our spirituality with our material position. So you can be so rich and spiritual, so poor and spiritual. You can be so rich and not spiritual. If spirituality, richness was the sign of spirituality, Ambani would have been the most spiritual person in the country that we are living in, right? Most of the people that are coming in the Forbes list of rich people, we don't see many Christians there. Why? Because that is not the sign. If that was the sign, Christ would have put all the people up there and say that, okay, see, follow me, I will make you rich. This is the sign that you are in right standing with God. No, that is not what I'm saying. See, again, coming back to that question, is God against our material possessions? I would say an emphatic no. God is not against material possessions, because Jesus needed money to pay tax. Jesus fed the 5,000 with bread and fish. And for missions that we are doing, we need money. For living, we need money. Bible says a man should be taking care of his family and his children. So money is needed. We are not saying that money is evil. By the way, Jesus preached about money second to the kingdom of God. But if you talk pick-wise, if you see the preachings of Jesus, he preached more about money. But the problem is my trust in money and evaluating my spirituality on the basis of money. That is where we miss. So do we have rich people in the Bible? Yes, we have rich people in the Bible. Nicodemus was a rich person. Lydia in Philippi was a rich person. Philemon was a rich person. A slave owner, he was a rich person. So richness is not an issue, but using spirituality to gain rich and evaluating your spiritual standing with richness, that is the problem, I would say.
And what about suffering? Do you say that as a Christian, I have to suffer? If I'm not suffering, then I'm not truly living a Christian life?
Siyashwe, it's a very good question. Again, the assumption is good people don't suffer. I mean, suffering happens to bad people. That's where we always come from, you know. But if you go through the scripture, see, this whole idea of applying the blood or chanting Psalm 91, these are all thinking that, you know, we are going to stay here. Suffering is not part of our life. We are going to leave this body one day or the other. Sickness is going to come. We have to cease to exist. I was telling the church that 91 may not work when you are 91. Okay? I mean, this whole idea that we keep saying the Psalm 91, this is going to make you stay, for immortality. No. It is not going to happen. We have to say goodbye and we have to go away from this world. So how it will happen? It will happen either through sickness. It will happen through sickness only. We will cease to exist. Suffering. Can it happen to Christian people? Sickness, I told you, I gave you the example of Paul, a good, great man of God who understood the righteousness of God, was sick when he was preaching in Galatia. He prayed for Epaphroditus in Philippi. He wanted him to be healed. So sickness is there. He is telling Timothy, his prodigy, to take some wine because of his stomach issue. Can't he pray once and heal all these things? Can't he apply Psalm 91 or blood of the lamb and say that it is not there? No. See, sometimes it will not work that way. See, the great man of God who passed away from to the eternity, our Rabbi Zacharias, he used to quote this beautiful psalm, a hymn written by Annie Johnson Flint. He talks about, he giveth more grace when the burdens grow greater. He sendeth more strength when labors increase. To added affliction, he addeth his mercy. To multiply trials, he multiplies his grace. His love has no limit. His grace has no measure. His power no boundary, none unto man. Out of his infinite riches in Jesus, he giveth and giveth and giveth again. And he continues to say that when, see, this is a hymn written by a person who was confined to a wheelchair because of rheumatism, and he was diagnosed with cancer, an orphan adopted by some family, Annie Johnson Flint. So he looked at her life, she looked at her life and saw grace in a completely different way. She was not saying that grace was when I can walk. She understood grace, that even if I am confined to this wheelchair for the rest of my life, I am in the perfect will of God. I am in grace. What is the scriptural backup for this? See, Jesus said, you will have trouble in this world. I have given an example of Paul's life, the troubles that he had to go through. In 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse number 9, he said, I want you to know, church, what all things we have gone through in Ephesus, we thought we were sentenced to death. He had fearful situations that he thought he would die. And he says in Romans chapter 8 that suffering is the sign of your sonship. And the preaching that is going on these days is saying that if you are Abraham's children and if you have Abraham's blessing, you don't have any suffering. It is all very good and nice, and you will become rich and all those things. But he says, if you are the sons of God, your sonship is proven by suffering. If you want to inherit, then you have to go through suffering. That is what it says. And suffering becomes so integral part of a man's journey. Philippians chapter 1, verse number 28. The gift that is given to you is not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for him. So the suffering is integral part of a Christian's walk. We cannot negate. So our spirituality is not determined by the lack of it at all. Because Jesus said, when you come to Christ, you have to carry the cross and follow. Cross is not a sign of comfort. Cross is a sign of pain, rejection, and loneliness. So that is the way that God has asked us to walk in. But sometimes we want to give a gospel, Ashribai, that is concerning this life alone. And we want to accommodate the wealth into our gospel and give a defense to the wealth that we have accumulated. That's why we go for this kind of an explanation. One more thing I will say. I believe our application that we draw about suffering, pain, wealth, and all those things should be applicable universally. Why do I say so? It should be applicable in the place that you are in America. It should be applicable in Delhi that I am in. It should be applicable to the Coptic Christian who are giving their head to be chopped off. It should be applicable to the tribal community who is just knowing God. So if my idea, my revelation is not applicable universally, that means when I become Christ, there is no suffering. Everything is very great. It doesn't happen that way. Some people die. Some people are still in sickness. Annie Johnson Flint is another example, a good example. Rabbi Zacharias is a good example. All those people that I have said, he's a great example of people, those who go through physical suffering. And physical suffering is not, lack of it, is not the sign of our spirituality. We should not be looking at like that.
Again, you know, agar aap सफरिंग के बारे में जब सोचते हैं, आई एम श्योर कि बहुतों के दिमाग में आता है पर्सिक्यूशन के बारे में, बहुतों के दिमाग में आता है दुख उठाने के बारे में. यू नो दैट इज जस्ट अ पार्ट ऑफ इट. यू नो, मैं एक एग्जांपल आपको देना चाहता हूँ. आप सफर कर सकते हैं वाइल यू आर डूइंग ऑल गुड इन योर लाइफ. समझ रहे हैं. फॉर एग्जाम्पल मेरे एक बहुत ही अच्छे मित्र हैं और उन्होंने अपनी जॉब में अपने प्रमोशन को सिर्फ इसलिए खो दिया क्योंकि वो अपने अपने बिलीफ को लेकर, अपने एथिक्स को लेकर कॉम्प्रोमाइज नहीं करना चाहते थे, क्योंकि उन्हें कुछ बातों के ऊपर कॉम्प्रोमाइज करने के लिए कहा जा रहा था और उन्होंने उसके लिए मना कर दिया. यू नो माय वाइफ यू नो शिप्रा, जब वो ग्राफिक डिजाइनर थी, मुझे याद आता है उनका एग्जाम्पल वो बता रही थी कि जब वो डिजाइनिंग में थी तो उन्हें कुछ ऐसी चीजें डिजाइन करने के लिए कही गई जो कि उनके विश्वास के विरोध में थी, जो कि परमेश्वर को महिमा नहीं देती थी, तो उन्होंने उसके लिए मना कर दिया. उसकी वजह से उन्होंने उन्हें उन्हें एक अच्छी पोजीशन खोनी पड़ी, उसकी वजह से उन्होंने उन्हें एक अच्छा पैकेज खोना पड़ा. सो दैट इज अ सफरिंग. यू नो आप परमेश्वर के लिए दुख उठा रहे हैं अपने विश्वास के लिए. यू नो ये चीज हर किसी के साथ में होगी. यू नो जरूरी नहीं है कि आपको मार ही पड़ेगी या जरूरी नहीं है कि आपको आपको उस तरह के दुखों से. यू नो देयर आर डिफरेंट वेज हम सफर करते हैं, लेकिन एक बात जरूरी है कि हर एक विश्वासी हमारी बुलाहट है सफर करने की, दुख उठाने की मसीह के साथ में. यू नो हमें दुख उठाना है और ये हमारी सबकी बुलाहट है. पास्टर जेबी, आपने एक पॉइंट टच किया था अभी जब आप बोल रहे थे एब्राहमिक ब्लेसिंग के बारे में. प्लीज आप थोड़ा सा और एब्राहमिक ब्लेसिंग के बारे में बताइए, उसका मतलब क्या है एंड हाउ that is relevant, how we can see that in our generation, in our time.
Ashley bhai, this is one of the most used verses in the New Testament to defend the amassing of the wealth that happened to certain people. You know, it happens. And also we misunderstand it by saying that Abrahamic blessing means that I have become rich materially. Because there is a verse in Genesis chapter 24, it talks about it, that the Lord has blessed my master and he became rich. So there was a time when land was the place that they lived, physical land, and the covenant was connected to that land. The blessings were physical. So God wanted to show to the whole world that this is Abraham's children. They are having the Abrahamic blessing. You call on to this name of Yahweh, you will be safe in this land. When you are not calling on to the name of Yahweh, and when you disobey the covenants and its precepts, you are going to go out of this land. I will take you out of this land. You will be in exile, in captivity. So that right standing of God made them stay in the land, prosper, and disobedience took them out of the land. This was old covenant. But come to the new covenant. You will be persecuted no matter what. When you are doing righteous, you will be persecuted. That is what Matthew chapter 5 talks about. Look at the life of Paul. When he is right, doing the right thing, he is being persecuted and chased away. So we cannot associate right standing with God as comfortable life's guarantee. That is one thing. Let me just come back to Abrahamic blessing. One more thing I would say and quickly move forward, Ashley. But Abrahamic blessing is mentioned in Galatians chapter 8, chapter 3, verse number 7, 8, and 9. Let me just read it to you if that okay, is okay with you. Galatians chapter 3, it says like this. I mean, this is something that we keep using. I mean, people keep using to say that Abrahamic blessing is material and material possessions are the blessing of God. But if you look closely in verse number 7, it says, understand then that those who have faith are children of Abraham. So all those who have faith. Earlier, it was the racial descendants of Abraham were Abraham's children. Now, all those who have faith became Abraham's children. I mean, that is clear. Scripture foresaw that God would justify the Gentiles by faith and announce the gospel in advance to Abraham. All nations will be blessed through you. If you read it slowly, you will understand that scripture is promising justification. If you believe, you will be justified. You and I agree that that is gospel, right? That is the gospel. And that gospel was announced in the Old Testament. What were the words that were used to announce that gospel in the Old Testament? It was announced like this, that in Abraham, all generations will be blessed. All nations will be blessed. So, that blessing, when it becomes actualized in us, it becomes justification for us. In other words, what is Abraham's blessing? It is the justification that we have in Christ Jesus. Again, come down to verse number 14. He redeemed us in order that the blessing given to Abraham might come to the Gentiles through Christ Jesus, so that by faith we might receive the promise of the Spirit. Here it is very clear. Abrahamic blessing is coming to us. What is the promise? The promise is the Spirit, and that Spirit is coming to us. It is not again talking about material possession. Then people might ask, so then material possessions are not in the part of God's blessing? I would say yes, it is there. But amassing wealth or abundance of wealth is not the sign of our spirituality. Yeah. This is the only thing that we are trying to make clear. So my spirituality is not directly proportionate to the amount of wealth I possess. Mm. No. There are spiritual people that are living in impoverished. When we say, you know, we are Christ's children, we are King's children, we should live in King's style. There are people in villages, there are people in tribal cities, they will never see a suite in a good hotel. They will never fly in a first class ticket. But still they are children of God, right? Still they are King's children, right? How can we apply it and say that only when you do this, this is the sign of our spirituality? No, there are so many people, those who don't go through that. I think we have to have a spirituality, a theology, where we have space for such people also. Material possessions and abundance of it is not the sign of our right standing with God. Abrahamic blessing is not material blessing, it is spiritual blessing. If Abrahamic blessing was material blessings, the one who wrote it, Paul, wouldn't have to die in a dungeon, chopping his head off when he was left with some parchments and one quilt, when he was such a rich man coming to such impoverished situation. He wouldn't have to, I mean, that means he failed to apply his own revelation in his life, right?
Yeah. And I think listening all that you are sharing about the Abrahamic blessing, and we were discussing about the suffering, we were discussing about the material blessing and the spiritual life, I think it all comes down to being content, isn't it? Mm-hmm. And you know, yes. Paul says that, you know, in Philippians chapter 4, verse 11, I have learned to be content in whatever the circumstances is. Quickly, you know, what do you say about living a content life? What does it really mean?
See, I want to put two words before our hearers. One is contentment and one is covetousness. Covetousness is a lalach. Hindi mein bolte hai na, lalach. You know, we want to have more for everything, you know, amassing wealth. Bible clearly says Jesus clearly says life is not found in the abundance of provisions, of possessions. Life is not found in the abundance of possessions. So life is not decided on how much I amass. Bible always talked about living a life of trusting in God. What if you ask me what is contentment? I would say this way. My contentment is my trust in the all sufficiency of God in all my needs. God is all sufficient, and He will come through to me at the right time of my need in the right way. And it doesn't mean that I will not lack, I will not have any trouble, I will have everything. No. I have an all sufficient God, and God asked me to trust Him. He will come through to me according to His riches and glory. He will meet my need. If you see, Ashley, by when we look at the Israelites, when they were walking through the wilderness, God gave them heavenly manna. Okay, manna was given, and manna had a trick. I mean, a catch in it. What was the catch? Catch was this: that they can take only for one day. Was it not a lesson of contentment? It was a lesson of contentment to say that today you take for this day. Tomorrow you come back. Tomorrow it will be there. Some people must be thinking, in case God forget to drop manna, and in case I'm lazy to get out and take it. Let me take for tomorrow. I mean, lack of trust with laziness, a lethal combination. People must have took more, and it got spoiled. And continuation is by to say that, no, every day I trust God for my provision. That is what Jesus teaches in his prayer. What does He say? He says, give us today our daily bread. Today. Give me what I need. In chapter number 6 again, Matthew, he says, do not worry about what you wear, what you eat, where you stay. The Heavenly Father knows. Worry is not the way. Trust is the way. I look at my material possessions in these three ways. One is, I don't worry because my God is my shepherd. He will care for me. Okay? Do not worry, Jesus said in Matthew chapter 6. And when I follow what I ought to follow, what ought to follow will follow me. Okay? When I follow the kingdom of God and His righteousness, the basic need will be given to me. It is God's prerogative. God will give. Even if He is not giving, that is not deciding my spirituality. That is not deciding my love for Him. But I am sure He is the Father. He will give. I trust. I do not worry. Second, I add, and then we can stretch and say, actually, bhai, okay, I can trust. I can trust for as big as anything. I can say, okay, this will come, that will come, everything. I can use faith as a magic word to get every will, wish, and fantasy of mine. No. I have to have a cap of contentment. I should say that this is enough, that we saw in Manna's story, that we saw in the prayer of Jesus, that we saw in Paul's life. Paul is saying, as you have read in Philippians chapter 4, isn't it? Paul lived a uber-rich life sometimes and impoverished life sometimes. In chapter 28 of Acts, he was in governor's house. 3 weeks, 3 months. I mean, maybe a royal treatment. But prior to that, in 27, he was in the middle of the sea on the deck with 276 prisoners and people. He's breaking bread and say that, brothers, please eat this. Somehow we will reach the other shore. We will not die here. Both are spiritual. And we have somehow, Ashbay, you must have heard several people preaching that if you happen to be in that situation where your life is threatened, you are under curse. If you are in governor's house, you are blessed. No. Both these things are realities that can happen in a man's life. But one thing that is constant is, I am content in the all sufficiency of God. Lastly, on top of that should come generosity. We should be keep giving it. Do not worry what you will eat. God provides. Coupled with contentment that it is enough. God's sufficiency is enough for me. And coupled with contentment, I think we can have a good theology about material possessions.
Amen. Amen to that. Or I really feel what Pastor Jebby said. I believe what he has said is the way to go and see this entire picture. Kyunki jab hamare paas contentment, santushti nahi hoti hai, tab wo cheezein har cheez mein dikhai deti hai. Tab hum log panic ho jate hain, chahe fir wo sickness ho, chahe suffering ho, chahe koi bhi dusra area of hamari zindagi ka ho. So live a content life, you know. And jaise Pastor Jebby ne teen baatein batayi. विश्वास रखिए परमेश्वर पे, चिंता मत कीजिए, भरोसा रखिए परमेश्वर पे, संतुष्ट रहिए और उदार बनिए, बी यू नो जेनरस हार्ट रखिए. हमारी यही प्रार्थना है कि इन बातों को और अधिक निकाल के लेके आए, आपकी अंडरस्टैंडिंग को और भी अधिक ठीक करे. क्योंकि देखिए प्रभु का वचन कहता है कि उसके वचन के ज्ञान के अभाव में उसके लोग नाश हुए चले जाते हैं ना. आज भी यही हो रहा है कि बहुत सारे लोग नाश हो रहे हैं, गलत अंडरस्टैंडिंग में फंसे हुए हैं. और इसलिए उसका नतीजा ये होता है कि शैतान आपको ड्रैग कर लेता है एक ऐसी जगह पे जहां पर आप अपने परमेश्वर को अपने दुश्मन के रूप में देखने लगते हैं, जहां पर आप परमेश्वर को देखने लगते हैं कि नहीं नहीं परमेश्वर मेरी भलाई नहीं चाहता, परमेश्वर ये सब कुछ इसलिए कर रहा है कि परमेश्वर मुझे मारना चाहता है, मुझे दंड देना चाहता है. दैट इज नॉट द पिक्चर ऑफ गॉड द फादर. ये वो तस्वीर नहीं है उस परमेश्वर की जो असली है. ये वो खराब और बुरी तस्वीर है जो कि दुश्मन आपको दिखाना चाहता है और चाहता है कि आप उसी नजर से अपने परमेश्वर को देखें, कि वो आपको ताड़ना देना चाहता है, वो आपको गरीब रखना चाहता है, वो आपको चंगा नहीं करना चाहता, वो आपको बीमारियों में मारना चाहता है. ऐसा नहीं है. इनफैक्ट बाइबल बताती है कि मसीह में सारी आशीषों का भागी परमेश्वर ने आपको और मुझे बनाया है. ऑलराइट, सो याद रखिए इस बात को एक बार फिर से. आज हमने बहुत सारी बातें डिस्कस की हैं और इसलिए मैं आपसे रिक्वेस्ट करूंगा बार बार जा जाके इसको देखें और समझें इन बातों को. एंड अगेन पास्टर जेबी दिल्ली के अंदर है, गुड़गांव में रहते हैं. आप ग्लोबल क्रिश्चियन लाइफ सेंटर जो कलीसिया जिनके वो पास्टर हैं, आप वहां पर जा सकते हैं, पर्सनली उनसे मिल सकते हैं. अगर आप वहां नहीं जा सकते हैं तो फेसबुक पे आप उनको रिक्वेस्ट भेज सकते हैं. पास्टर जेबी थॉमस उनको सर्च कर सकते हैं, उनके लिए लिंक भी आ रहा है नीचे, आप उनसे बात कर सकते हैं और अपने सवालों के जवाब जो परमेश्वर ने ज्ञान दिया है, जिसे जिस अद्भुत बुद्धि से भरा है, उसके द्वारा आप उन्हें समझ सकते हैं। तो एक बार फिर से परमेश्वर का धन्यवाद हो इस दिन के लिए, इस समय के लिए, इस पूरे कॉन्वर्जेशन के लिए जो हमने किया। आई एम श्योर कि आपके बहुत सारे जवाब आपको मिल गए होंगे, अगर नहीं मिले होंगे तो प्लीज रीच आउट टू मी, मुझसे आप सवाल पूछ सकते हैं इसके बारे में, पास्टर जैबी से आप संपर्क कर सकते हैं। थैंक यू वंस अगेन पास्टर जैबी, आपने समय दिया और इतना अच्छे से आपने इन सवालों के जवाबों को हम सबको बताया। आई एम श्योर कि बहुत से लोगों ने आशीष पाई। जाने से पहले मैं चाहता हूं कि आप प्रार्थना करें उन सब लोगों के लिए जो इस समय इस मुश्किल घड़ी से होकर गुजर रहे हैं और इन सारे सवालों से होकर जो आज हमने पूछा है, हो सकता है कि वो लोग गुजर रहे हों। प्लीज आप हमारी प्रार्थना में अगुवाई करें कि पवित्र आत्मा हमारी सहायता करे कि हम इस समय से निकल सकें और एक अच्छी अंडरस्टैंडिंग परमेश्वर की लिए हुए यहां से आगे बढ़े।
Ashish bhai, I just want, I mean, I welcome all the questions. If there is anybody who wants to ask and have a conversation, open to that. One more thing I want to say is let's not, I mean, there is no simplistic answer for life's difficult questions like suffering and sickness and pain. So we always want simple answers. It may not be that simple to deal with. But we can still search the scripture and try to find answers. I just want to leave this thought with you and then I will pray. Listen, God is in control. He is good. He is sovereign. Whatever that He does is for the good of those who love Him and called according to His purpose. COVID is also is not out of His control. He is not sending a SMS to the Father saying that, oh my God, what is happening? No. He knows it. He knows what is happening. He is in control. I always say God never sends bomb MG message. No, he will not say. He always knows what is happening. So that God is in control of your life. May that confidence rise in your heart that God is at work in your life, Romans 8:28. No matter what you are, where you are. Prior to that, there is so much of frustration, pain, tears, groaning, everything. In all these things, God is working for the good of those who love Him and called according to His purpose. May I pray with you. Father God, just want to thank you for giving us this time with my friend, Brother Ashish Bhai, to discuss certain things, to ask questions and try to answer. Lord, none of us are experts to give answers to all the questions that are out there. But we are learners. We are going through this journey, trying to figure out what you are speaking to us in each of the scenarios that we are in. But there are some basic truths that has been forgotten by people and not being talked about because they want to preach a gospel that is palatable, that is satisfying the hearers, that pure demanding gospel, O Lord. That's why we don't talk about suffering. That's why we don't talk about pain. That is why we want to picture everything so flowery, but in reality it may not be so. But we pray, Lord Jesus, that our physical well-being should never be associated, O Lord, with our spiritual stand with you, because we have seen so many good Christians affected by this thing, this issue, and we have in the past so many good Christians going through physical suffering. It doesn't mean that sin was there. It doesn't mean that they had some secret issues, but it's just because they were part of the fallen humanity. Lord, help us to understand this. Help us to trust in you no matter what it is. Help us to have that faith of the Hebrew boys that says, we believe that God will deliver us. Even if he doesn't deliver us, we will still have faith in God. Help us to continue in this manner. And I pray for your blessing upon every hearer. Let them think about it. Let them read more. Let them ask questions more. Because you want us to be disciples. And a disciple is obviously somebody who learns. Let it happen to us. Let our hope be true, not fake, shallow hope. Deep-rooted, word-rooted hope. Give us, O Lord. We give you all glory and honor. In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Jebby, for taking time and answering all those biblical questions. And Thank you once again. Thank you. Please remember Pastor Jebby in your prayer. Pastor Jebby, उनकी पत्नी और उनके दो बच्चे हैं. आप इस छोटे परिवार को आप जरूर प्रार्थना में याद रखिए. उनकी कलीसिया, जैसा कि मैंने कहा, ग्लोबल क्रिश्चियन लाइफ सेंटर गुड़गांव में है. आप उस कलीसिया को याद रखिए. अगर आप कभी गुड़गांव में जाते हैं, आप वहां पर जा सकते हैं. याद रखिए इस पूरे परिवार को, प्रभु के दास को, कि प्रभु उन्हें और भी अधिक इस्तेमाल करे आने वाले समय में, और अपने वचन का प्रचार उनके द्वारा और भी लोगों तक पहुंचाए, और बहुत सी आत्माएं उनके सेवा के द्वारा बचाई जाए. थैंक यू पास्टर जेबी वंस अगेन. आपका शुक्रिया करते हैं ये समय हमें देने के लिए.
थैंक यू एश्ली भाई. इट वाज एन ऑनर टू चैट विद यू. रिमेंबर द डेज दैट वी स्टार्टेड आवर जर्नी इन दिल्ली. एंड मे गॉड ब्लेस यू एंड ब्लेस शिप्रा एंड आल्सो द चिल्ड्रन. आई एम सो ग्लैड टू सी व्हाट गॉड इज डूइंग थ्रू योर लाइफ. रिमेंबर आवर फर्स्ट मीटिंग परिवर्तन with your band in Bible Bhavan. The first meeting I was there. So God is working in you. God is continuing to bless you and use you to be an influence. And to all hearers, God bless you. Thank you for listening to us. God bless.
Thank you, JV Bhai. Thank you, JV Bhai, for all that you are doing. May God richly bless you. God bless you all. Thank you.